Good evening, ברשות כבוד הרב. Thank you to Ronen that brought me here. I'm going to make a little nice salad here with few different topics. Hopefully will answer I see different kind of people here, so I'll try to approach everyone here. For those who already keep mitzvot and those who do not keep mitzvot yet, the idea is very simple. Hashem put us here, He brings us to the world. We used to be here before in a different body. The fact that we came here again, it's because we have another chance to correct. If we wouldn't have to correct, we wouldn't have to come here. Somebody that left this world perfect is finished this tikkun, doesn't have to come here. So the fact that we are here obviously leaves no doubt that we left some things open. Now the question is, are we correcting what we have to correct? Or like we say in Hebrew, we tochanim maim, we grinding water. What are we doing? You may say, what do you mean? Don't you see, I have a yarmulke, I have tzitzit, I come to daven mincha. What else do you want? I keep Shabbat, no? I give some tzedakah, I fast on Yom Kippur, I eat matzah on Pesach, I put tefillin every day. Look how many mitzvot I do. So, in case you didn't know, in the name of the Gaon Mivilna, that you can count on one hand how many rabbis in his level we had in the last 1,000 years, when they ask him, students, Rabbi, what's the purpose of life? Why Hashem needed all this? Why He put us here? Why all these desires that we have? All these nisyonot, all these tests that Hashem gives to us? What for? What all this for? So the answer of the Gaon Mivilna in one sentence, Tikkun ha-midot ze kol ha-adam. Correcting your personality, your traits, that's what all human being is all about. You may think, he would say, to learn Torah all day, like we hear every day, to keep Shabbat, to be religious. There's a lot of purposes, no? To be Baal Tzedakah v'Chesed, of course, everything is important, no doubt. But the Gaon Mivilna didn't say this. He said one sentence. He said, Tikkun ha-midot ze kol ha-adam. If a person came here negative and he left positive, then he fulfilled his obligation. Now the only way to do it, the only way to do it is through Torah and mitzvot. That's the secret of life. There's no way to correct your personality, your traits, without discipline, without learning daily Torah and Musar, especially Musar, and learning from our fathers, from the great rabbis that we had. Without that, it's very difficult. No? It's almost impossible to improve. We say in a prayer every day, Baruch Ata Hashem Rofe Chole Amo Yisrael. Why we say such a thing that it's not correct? Why? We have to be precise in a tefillah. Why do we say Rofe Chole Amo Yisrael? The Chinese don't get their cure from Hashem. The Arabs, who makes them so strong besides the za'atar that they eat? Hashem makes them very strong, no? If an Arab has cancer and he becomes cured, Hashem cure him, no? Everything. The animals, who cure them? All the animals, the dogs, the cats, the donkeys. Hashem is curing everyone. So why we lie in a tefillah? Why we say Rofe Chole Amo Yisrael? It's a better praise, better shvach to Hashem to say that He's the doctor of all universe. Not only 13.2 million people. How many Jews do you have in the world? A drop of a drop. 1% of 1% of the Chinese people. So to praise Hashem that He's only taking care of 13 million people when there's 6.4 billion people others, it's not a correct statement. So obviously, this is not what it means, the bracha. We're not talking about curing the bodies like we think. 99% of the people who pray 3 times a day for years, that's what they think. Rofe Chole Amo Yisrael means I have fever, now I'm cured. As for Shalom, I had cancer, now I got out of it. That's called Baruch Ata Hashem Rofe Chole Yisrael, Rofe Chole Amo Yisrael. The answer is no. We already mentioned it in the beginning of the Tfilat Shmona Esre, that Hashem is a doctor. There's no need to repeat it again. What's the secret here? The secret here is the cure of the nefesh, not the cure of the body. Cure of the body, we already say thank you. Right in the beginning. רופא חולים, עתיר אסורים, זה... We say that already. We say that in the morning, we say it in the beginning of תפילת 18, we say that enough. What's the secret here? רופא חולה עמו ישראל means a person is mentally healed and Hashem cure him. How? With the Torah. Without the Torah you cannot cure the neshama, the nefesh. Now you may tell me, I don't remember I ever been mentally healed. I never went to Abarbanel. You know Abarbanel? It's a hospital in Israel. Everyone become crazy, they put him there. People who talk to themselves, who make faces, change their accent. Every day they have something new. So the answer is, we recognize this kind of people as crazy. When in reality, most of them are not really crazy. Either they have a dibuk, something that affected them. It could be another soul enter their body and drives them crazy because now there's two people in one body. So they talk to themselves in two different accents, sometimes in different languages, because now it's not one person, it's two people working the mouth. Sometimes it's Reuven, sometimes it's Shimon, depends who takes control. It's like two pilots trying to fly the jet, one to Iraq, one to Israel. They fight. Whoever gets the chair, he's controlling the plane. Whoever speaks now, he controls the body. When the other one's controlled, he speaks in a different way, different language, different accent, sometimes can be a man and a woman. The doctors, since they never learned Torah and Kabbalah, so they right away say they're crazy. Give them some shots, make them relax, finished. Sometimes these kind of people are healthier than us. Why? When we say chole nefesh, what do we mean, really, according to the Torah? What does it mean, chole nefesh? Chole nefesh means, let's see if we are in this category or not. Include myself. I don't talk to you. I talk to all of us. First, can anybody raise his hand here and say that he's not stingy? Not cheap? I doubt it. Can anybody say that he's not proud? He doesn't have ego? I doubt it. Can anybody say that he's not angry? That almost every day he's getting angry, scream at his wife, his children, his partner, his customers, in traffic. Somebody cut him, he's ready to kill him already. And can anybody say that he's not lazy? Can anybody say that he's not addicted to food? All day, what we're gonna eat, how delicious it's gonna be, where we're gonna go again, which restaurant, what? Can anybody say that he's not addicted to material? He loves the pleasure of this world and all he thinks about, when will I enjoy next? This is all sicknesses of the nefesh. תחלואי הנפש, as the מקובלים and the חכמים writes, especially the Ramchal speaks about it a lot. So we all mentally ill, some more, some less. Some of us are a little bit stingy. We also generous, but sometimes we're very cheap, we don't want to give. Some of us are more angry than the others. The more negative you have, the more you have to work hard to get rid of it. Now I give you another example. Sometimes you look at two Jews, one of them looks tzaddik, one looks rasha. Is it possible that in Shamayim is the opposite? Is it possible? I give you an example. You see a Jew, he dressed very modern, pink shirt, very small yarmulke, jeans. You know, when he prays 2 minutes, the other one prays 10 minutes, the other one wears jackets, black hats, long beard. There's nothing to compare, right? If you look at both of them, you say, oh, this guy is very religious. This guy is half enough. Right? That's what everybody would say. But in Shamayim, it could be the other way around. How can it be? How can it be? The answer is, when they're born, each one born in a certain level. For instance, we have Reuven and Shimon. Reuven looks very, very orthodox. Long beard, black hat, very yeshivish. Shimon looks very modern. When Reuven was born, from his previous life, he was almost perfect. He was already at 60, 70. He was in high level. From 100, he was already rated at 70. He did a lot, he kept Shabbat, he learned a lot of Torah, he was Baal Tzedakah, he worked on his midot, he raised his children to Torah, his wife covered their hair, almost everything. He has some problems. That's why Hashem brought him here again. And Shimon, he died 20. Hardly kept mitzvot. Once a year he fasts on Yom Kippur, here and there he put a dollar in a box. Almost nothing. Mechalel Shabbat, goes with the goyot. That's how he died. When they come to their trial, how long is the trial in Shamayim? 1 year. That's why we say Kaddish 12 months. 11 months, we stop for a week, and then 3 more weeks, and we finish the entire year. Why? This relative of us needs our help. 1 year, he has a trial. Every irhur, every thought he had, he has to analyze together with Hashem, and Hashem decide if it was positive, negative, what's his mark for it. He's going to get reward or punishment, chas v'shalom. So after this whole thing, when Hashem brought him back, since he died 70, he was born 70. Now he has to go to 80, 90, to 100. That's his goal. But he was born 70. What does it mean to be born 70? Your father is a chief rabbi in a town. You're born to a very religious neighborhood. You have the best chachamim, the best rabbis. All your cousins are all important rabbis. That's called born 70. Your personality, automatically you're attracted to Torah, to mitzvot, because you died 70. You don't go down. Hashem brings you back from where you left. The other guy that died 20 was born 20. Now, when you look at both of them right now, the one who was born 20 made a big step forward. He jumped to 50. Still, 50 looks not so good. It looks very modern, you know, half enough. But he made a big step forward from 20 to 50. It's very big improvement. The other one, from 70, went up to 80. So now when you compare between them, this one looks 80, this one looks 50. But the one who looks 80 only achieved 10% improvement this life. The other one achieved 30% improvement. So Hashem appreciates him more in this life. You understand? That means he is more tzaddik than the other one in this life, because he achieved more. That's why Chazal say, never judge a person until you be in his own place, in his own feet, in his own shoes. Why? What looks easy for you is very difficult for him. For instance, if you're a kosher person, and you have a wife, and you're very faithful, and you don't look at the other ladies, and you don't talk to them, you keep yourself in a very good discipline. And then there's another one with the yarmulke, that once in a while he looks. It's very hard for him not to look. So right away he says, Rasha, this looks at the ladies on the street, what's going on here? But if you be in his test, you would look 100 times more than him. That's what Chazal said. Don't rush to judge him. You don't have his desire. Same thing food. Sometimes you see two Jews sit at a table, and the food is not so kosher. Maybe yes, maybe not. Questionable. We don't know which hashgacha, we don't recognize it. Maybe it's good, maybe it's bad. 50-50 chance. Some of us are very weak. Okay, only this time I'm hungry. Yalla, next time I'm going to try to do better. Some of us starving, they won't touch. What happened, Moshe? Eat, eat. I don't touch. I don't know who is the mashgiach. Even though maybe it's kosher, but maybe it's not. I don't touch. But there's no food until tomorrow. We have a flight to catch. Come on, eat. I don't touch. So now the one who didn't touch, everyone say, wow, look what a strong guy. Not necessarily. The other guy in his previous life already corrected the kashrut problem. He doesn't have strong desire for not kosher food. The one who did not correct, for him it's like to commit suicide not to eat. I see by the kids. Sometimes you see kids that you don't give them candy, they go crazy. They cry for 3 hours. Sometimes the kid gets a little upset and he goes to play. Doesn't kill him. You see right away. How does he know? He's 2 years old, this one 2 years old. This one dying for candies, this one don't care so much. See right away. Also, I'll give you another example. How generous are the kids? Not every baby is the same generosity. Some kids, you give them a bag of pretzels, you tell them, give me one, he won't give you. Some of them, you give them a whole bag, you tell them, give me one, he takes one or two and he gives you the whole bag. It's very generous. And the other one is very stingy. Now, I always use this example because it's very strong. Who told these 2 years old babies if it's better to be stingy or generous? They have no idea what's stingy, they have no idea what generous. Nobody sent them to school. How did they know? Maybe I have a million bags of pretzels in my closet. I can give them as much as I want. So why is he so nervous to give me one? Why it's killing him when he gave me one? Why is he crying if I took another one? Because he died like this. 5, 10 years ago he was in a different body of an old man. when he wrote a check for $18, for 3 weeks he did not sleep after that. That's how Hashem made him. He died like this, and he's born again. And I know plenty of people like this. They mamash suffer. I just came from one state. I had lectures over there. I'm not saying names where. And the guy who took me around in the car, he showed me, you see, this big complex belongs to one person. Then we drove two blocks. You see this whole big buildings, maybe 50 stores belongs to him. You see all this one restaurant, another one, and another one, and across the street. Almost, we're driving for 20 minutes, almost everything on the right and on the left belong to this guy. And then he says to me, I one time drove with him in a car, him and two of his brothers, and I don't even have a millionth of what they have, as far as money. And they were arguing who's going to throw the quarters into the toll. Get angry. They're fighting. You understand what's going on here? Yeah, yeah. I knew a guy that used to drive a very rich diamond dealer, very, very rich. And when he fell asleep in a car, they got to a gas station. So the guy put gas. So while he was putting gas, there was noise in the gas station. So the rich guy opened up his eyes and he asked him, "What kind of gas are you putting?" Okay, sleep. You already know who he's dealing with. Sleep. No, tell me, answer me. Screams. Say, I put super. How many times I told you put the cheap gas? $2 difference, $3 difference. It's worth maybe $50 million. This is a sickness. It's called mahalat nefesh. It's not about money or not. It's called mahalat nefesh. If you don't cure it, you have to come again. If you're lucky, you come again. Some of us don't come again. I don't want to tell you where we go. There's two ways to clean. To clean the soul from all the problems, there's two ways. One, with your free choice. As long as you're alive, you have the choice to do it or not. And one is when you die, Hashem forced you to clean. I'm only going to give you a hint that it's much better to clean it when you're alive, because it's not so painful. Yeah, you have to fight with your desires. I'm not saying no. But over there, when they will clean your soul, it's going to be a lot more painful and not so convenient. Just by a hint, I don't want to go into details. So the idea is that as long as we are alive, we have a choice. Now you have to remember that we don't have a free choice. We have a choice, but it's not free. What's the difference between free choice and choice? What's the difference? Free choice means, you want to make money, come work for me tomorrow, I'll pay you $100. You come a few hours, I give you $100. You don't come, your problem. Go to sleep, I don't care. You don't come. No hard feelings. That's free choice. Nobody tells you what to do. You get up in the morning, should I go, should I not go? Let me sleep. I give up the $100, I won't make money. I stay the same. That's free choice. But in the Torah, you don't find choices like this. What do you find in the Torah? If you come to work tomorrow, you'll get $100. You don't come, you lose $100. The Torah always have two sides. If you listen to me, if you follow my laws, I will reward you. If you don't, I will punish you severely. Everywhere in the Torah. Can anybody raise his hand and show me one place in the Torah that you find one time that Hashem asked us to do something and there was no reward and punishment subject to it? Find one time. Everywhere that Hashem is speaking about keeping mitzvot, he shows you both ways. Re'e anochi noten lifnechem t'chaim ve'et ha'tov, et ha'mavet ve'et ha'ra, uvacharta b'chaim. I'm giving you the life and the good, the bad and the dead, and you should choose the life. Which means you can choose the bad and the death. It's your choice. It's not even punishment. That's the problem here. Punishments, what we call punishment, if you review the Torah, there's really no punishment. It's reality. Reality. What's the difference between punishment and reality? I'll explain. Reality means, punishment means I tell my son, I don't want you to go outside in the next hour. So if you go outside, I have hundreds of difference of punishments to give him. I can take away his money, I can put him in a room, I can take away his bike, I can give him a patch. So many things I can do. I have to decide what I want to do. So today I give him a patch, next week I put him in a room, a year later I took his bike, every time different punishments. I decide. But if I make a system with rules, the system is already ready. Before we started the game, you already know what the rules are. And the rules are, if you touch this button, you die. If you touch this button, you make 100 bucks. If you touch this button, you become sick. If you touch this button, you get married. If you touch this button, you lose your wife. Everything is known in advance. And you chose to press the button to die, and you die, nobody killed you, you killed yourself. So far, everything is clear. So if I make fire, and I put signs around it, be careful, fire, life risk, do not enter, do not enter. If you will not enter into the fire, I will reward you one day. If you enter into the fire, you will die. Be careful, signs all over. And one fool came and jumped into the fire, and he got burned, half of his body is all scars. Can he sue me? Can he take me to court and complain against me after I put so many warnings around the fire? Does he have any complaints? Am I righteous or wicked? I'm righteous. Why? I told you, be careful, be careful, be careful. Do not touch, do not enter, do not enter. Life freeze, you'll die. Be careful, be careful, be careful. You went in anyway? Why are you complaining against me? Complain against yourself. That's exactly how the Torah is. How many times the Torah warned the Jews not to be mechalel Shabbat? How many times? The Torah says, Lo tevaru esh bechol moshvotechem. Do not dare to create any energy, no fire, nothing, anywhere you're going to live on a seventh day, on Shabbat. How many Jews decide to ignore it? Many. Why the Jews continue to be mechalel Shabbat every Shabbat? Because they don't see their punishments. The opposite, business is booming on Shabbat. If every day he makes $2,000 in a cash register, Shabbat comes, he makes $5,000. Where is the justice? The Torah. Maybe in the old days the Torah was real, Rabbi. Today you see, look, here my friend is Shomer Shabbat, he drives a bicycle. I'm Mechalel Shabbat, I drive a Jaguar. So you see that the Torah is not real? You hear many foolish statements like these, they're everywhere you go. People are the same people. When they smart the same smart all over. When they foolish all over. Same nonsense. What's the answer to this comments? The answer is, nowhere in the Torah it says that the reward and the punishment is instant, that you get it right away. The opposite. Clearly in the Torah it says that everything comes in the afterlife. All the reward is when a person dies. Where does it say in the Torah that we will receive all our reward in Olam Haba? Where in the Torah? Not by the rabbis. Not in the Gemara. Not in Shulchan Aruch. Not in the Zohar. All over there, it's in hundreds of places. In the Torah, who knows? Where? Somebody asks you, where does it say in the Torah that the reward of Hashem comes in the afterlife, that there is life after life? Where? What is the answer? Clearly in the Torah. No, what do you say? Anybody knows? In few places. It says, I'm torturing you to test you, leman anotcha, lenasotcha, lirot et asher bilvavcha, to check what's in your heart. Will you keep my mitzvot or not? What comes right after that? Lehativcha beacharitecha. To reward you in your end. Acharit, it's end, sof. When your life will be over, I will reward you. When? In a grave? The worm's eating me up. What do I need your reward over there? Did you ever see a righteous person in a history that just before he died, Hashem called him and said, here, take your payment? Well, show me one rabbi that before he died, a year, two, five, he went somewhere and Hashem started to give him a reward. Now, on the opposite. All the old people, they suffer even more. The older they get, the more doctors, surgery, sicknesses, they cannot see, they walk with a cane, you know, cannot even go to the shul, the tzaddik. So where is the reward? So there's two options. One, to say chas v'shalom that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is a member in Israeli Knesset. He promised things and then he doesn't keep his words. And the other possibility is that Hashem is not a liar. So we have to understand what's going on here. So I want to ask you a question. If a person was taking a cigarette and lighting a cigarette on Shabbat, and according to the Torah says, Mechalel Shabbat mot yumat, will die in this world, and in the next world. Every time it's duplication, mot, yumat, mot for this world, yumat to the next life. same thing, chayo yichye. When a person makes tshuva, chayo in this world, yichye into the next world. So if a person lights a cigarette, according to the Torah, he's supposed to die. What would happen if a Jew would light a cigarette and explode to pieces? What would happen? The next Jew that would light a cigarette also explode. After two incidents happened, first Shabbat in the world, first Shabbat, two Jews light a cigarette, psh, explosion. Do you think that anybody ever, ever would light fire on Shabbat in the whole world? Why people would not light fire on Shabbat? Not because they obey the rules of God. Because nobody wants to die. Even the Arabs wouldn't light cigarettes after they saw two Jews going on fire. Nobody would move on Shabbat. Not only they won't light cigarettes, when Shabbat comes, everyone will be like this. Reuven, where are you? Shh. Shabbat started a minute ago. Don't talk. Why? Every move, fire, explosion, no, nobody can breathe. Nobody will go to the bathroom, nobody will eat, believe me. So there's no test. What's the test? When a person doesn't move because he's afraid to die, he deserves a reward? What reward he deserve? What for? Same thing, the opposite. If a person made a mitzvah, right away $1 million in his mailbox. You gave the shul $1,000 donation, you came to your car, $2,000 and a chair there waiting. Yeah? You help somebody, an old man, to cross the street. 2 minutes later, two people came and helped you with something else. Everything you do, you sit and learn 1 hour Torah, you come to the business, you see $1 million deal came in. Like this, working like a computer. This will eliminate the free choice. There will not be a choice. We will all be like the animals, live with instinct. When a dog sees fire, he runs away, because he knows the last time he touched fire, he got burned. From now on, it's programmed already. Fire, I run away. Water, I jump in. There is a cat, I begin to run after it. There's food, I run after the food. This is animals. By them, everything is clear. There's no reward and punishment. No lion ever went on a trial for eating a zebra. Yeah? Can you tell the lion, please wait 5 minutes before you eat the zebra. We still have 5 more pictures to take. We didn't finish up the pictures of the zebra. You know, we have a catalog. Wait 5 minutes and then you eat the zebra. Nobody to talk to. He's hungry right now. He'll eat the zebra. I don't know any other way. But we can think what to do. Should I do it? Should I not do it? I would lose. I will win. Better to wait. Better not to do it. So we can control our desires. That's why we're different than the animals. That's why we say every morning in a prayer, Mutar ha'adam min ha'behema ayin. Mutar comes from the word itaron. Itaron. What advantage the person has from the animals? The answer is nothing. The animals are better in everything. They run better, they're stronger, they're faster. Their life is much greater than us. There's only one difference. The soul. Milvad haneshama tehora, besides the pure soul, שהיא עתידה ליתן דין וחשבון לפני מלך מלכי המלכים הקדוש ברוך הוא. The only advantage that a person has, that he has a divine holy soul that will be judged in front of the king of all kings. What advantage is this, that one day we are going to be judged? Better not to be judged, better to be a horse. Eat, do whatever you want and finish. One day you become sand. What is the advantage to go on a trial? To go to hell or to heaven, that's the advantage. But it can be, it could end up very bad. So it's not an advantage. The answer is, since we have the possibility to earn so much, endless reward, and it's in our hand 100%, that's an advantage. If we fail, it's our fault, not the system's fault. The system is perfect. Hashem gave you poison, and eternity. You choose the poison, fine, it's your choice. But you could also choose the eternity. What does the Torah? Uvacharta b'chaim. Le'ma'an tichyeh. It's very interesting how the Torah comes to the Jew. If you pay attention to the words of Hashem, you will realize right away the secrets of life. What is it? The Torah says, Im tishmeru et mitzvotai, if you follow my Torah, my chukim, my mitzvot, what does it say? Le'ma'an tichyeh, ata v'zaracha acharecha. That you should live, you and your children after you. What do you mean that I should live? Right now I don't keep mitzvot. I don't live. I drive, I talk, I run, I eat, I sleep, I make money, business, I have a wife, everything fine. Just come from vacation. I live. Ahmed lives, Chris lives, Mr. Lee lives, and Yosef lives. Everybody lives. The one who keeps mitzvot, the one who doesn't keep mitzvot. The dog also is alive. The dog doesn't keep mitzvot, but he's alive. But it's very interesting, because according to the Torah, only someone who keeps mitzvot is considered alive. The language of Hashem is very clear. You cannot make mistake here. If you're going to keep my mitzvot, you're going to live. What do you learn from here? No, let's be clever, finally. What do you learn from here? That Hashem is telling the Jews, if you're going to keep my mitzvot, you would live. Which means, if you are not keeping my mitzvot, you are dead. You are dead. What do you mean I'm dead? I just talked for an hour. Dead people don't talk. Dead people don't run. Dead people do not smell and eat and all these things. I do all that, so I'm alive. Wrong. The body is alive. You move. The monkeys also move. Doesn't matter. Life, everywhere in the Torah, it's life of eternity. Because the soul is endless. The soul will never die. To live 67 years, it's an embarrassment to think that this is what God called life. Of course not. If we put a divine soul in our body, which means the soul would live for trillions of years, it's not even the beginning, who cares about the 67 years to call it life? No. Chazal say, "Ha'olam hazeh keheref ayin." Life in this world, it's like a blink of the eye. What does it mean, like a blink of the eye? When a person finished his life, he looks back, oh, it's over. That's how it looks. It's very interesting, because the eye, how many times a person blink every minute? More than 10 times. Every 60 seconds, more than 10 times. 12, 13, 11. You know, now when you blink, you never pay attention that you blink. It doesn't bother you. Drive, you blink, you drive, you're perfectly fine. You walk, you can blink. When you read, you blink, everything is fine. Why we need to blink? Why we need to blink? Few reasons. One is the muscle needs rest, every muscle. If you put your hands like this for 5 hours, that's it. Your hand will fall, you cannot. Your muscle will not be able to function anymore. So the muscle needs rest. So every few seconds, it gets a rest for tenth of a second, and it's like this, it's continuing. Second, it's windshield wipers. There's a lot of dust in the air, so it's once in a while you need to turn the windshield off. What else? Lachluchit. The eye gets dry. If it gets dry, it's a horrible feeling. So like this, it's moisturized the eye. So you see, what? It's over. You don't even pay attention. This is how Chazal called his life. Ha'olam hazeh keheref ayin. When a person died after 70, 80 years that he was here, even the person who had great life, money, business, successful, wife, children, everything fine. Everybody is jealous with this guy. Before he dies, you tell him, hey, Mr. Cohen, can you conclude your life? Here is a piece of paper and a pen. Write to us your life story. How long it will take this successful person to conclude his life? How many pages? How many pages? 3, 5, 10, 20 pages? How long you can write? I was born here, I went to school there, I had this, I had a girlfriend, I went to the army, 3 years I was there. Then I met my wife, we got married, we had children, I moved here, I moved to New York, I moved to Israel, I got divorced, I did this, that. He writes everything, 3 pages. That's it. To read his life story will take 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 10 minutes, 10 minutes. One time a guy was sick in a hospital, and a doctor came to him, quietly got into his room, and said, Mr. X, I have the cure to your sickness. So the Jew is 70 years old, he has $100 million in his bank account. Very successful Jew. But he's dying from cancer, what's the point of all this money? So the guy, the doctor comes to him, he's a Chinese doctor, he comes with a little glass of liquid, like this, and he said to the Jew, you see this? This is the end of all your problems. I smuggled it. Now I came from China. If you drink it, nobody knows about it. I made it up. I made experiments. It cured all cancer. Within an hour, you get up from this hospital and you run in the street now. So the Jew, wow, Eliyahu Navi, thank you very much. Hashem sent you, Baruch Hashem. So he said, the Chinese guy said, not so fast. I've been following you. I saw that Baruch Hashem, you're very successful. And you have $100 million in your accounts. So I will give it to you if you transfer to my account $99 million. $1 million I would leave you. I'm not so greedy. I leave you $1 million. Don't worry, you won't starve. But I want 99. And I want to tell you something. This medicine cost me less than $1 to make. But nobody knows the secret. You want it? Or you want to die like the doctor saying 2 hours you'll be dead? Based on what I've seen in my life, how people are afraid to die before they close their eyes, they're all nervous. Should never see this situation by people. But I saw it a few times. I saw how people trying to hold life. They beg people, give me bracha, pray for me, call this, call that. They know, nobody wants to leave. So the Jew agree. Sign here, sign here, sign here. Believe me, he doesn't read. Just give me the medicine. ברוך אתה אדוני אלוהינו מלך העולם שהכל נהיה בדברו. So the Jew signed. So the Chinese gave him the medicine, he drank, really an hour later he got up. Now how long the Jew is going to live? No guarantee. 70 years old. Maybe another day. Maybe another week. Maybe 5 years. Maybe 20 years. Nobody knows. But since he's 70 years old, you know, it's not a brand new car. It's a used product, no? 7 years old, every day he lives. It's a gift from Hashem. Most people make it to the 70s. Most people in the world, 73, 75, that's the average. So what's going on here? The doctor does not give him any insurance policy how long he's going to live. All he did is got him out of the bed. Tomorrow, chas v'shalom, he can get a different sickness. But the Jew gave 99 million. Why do I tell you this story? It's very interesting. Because how many years this Jew worked to make this $100 million? From the minute he remembered himself when he was 16, he went to work, started here, started there, then he bought a store, then a factory, then he sold it, and he bought a different business, stock market, conventions, meeting, courts, problem, lawsuits, he left his wife, his children, running like crazy, come home at 12 o'clock at night, 4 o'clock in the morning, he has a plane to catch. The biggest lowlife we scan, killed himself for this money, and then, in 1 second he gives everything, 50 years of sweat, and agony, and pain, maybe he would live another day. Doesn't make sense. Now Hashem gives you life free of charge. What do you do with that? Rabbi, there's a baseball game. 3 hours to sit and see the fools eating the ball with a piece of stick. Ah, why can we live without it? Goes to eat in a restaurant, 3 hours. How long a person need to eat? 2 minutes. 3 hours waste. Well, newspapers, 3 hours a day. 20 times 10 news. Another movie, another vacation, another this, another meeting. In the end, his life is gurni, zero. Now when you have life, you do nothing with that. Just when we are about to lose it, you will give everything you can to get a drop of it. Well, that doesn't make sense. Usually the people realize what they have only when they lose it. You know how many people got divorced and a minute later they realize what they just did? 5 years they were fighting in a court. I just came from a place that 2 billionaires, husband and wife, had a big battle. I won't tell you for how much money they were fighting, but I will tell you that the lawyers cost $20 million. I'll let you do your math. The lawyers, the bloodsuckers, took away from them $20 million. So just imagine for how much they were fighting. And just when they finished after years, years of fighting, years, the woman came to me and said, Rabbi, give me a blessing, I love my husband. I'm not lying. I say to myself, what's going on here? what is going on in this world? You only realize what you had when you lose it. Oh, now it's a new thing. You have to make your own breakfast. You sit alone in a house, you come from the office, you're alone, the wife, the children are not there. Oh, I thought I'll get divorced, my life will be a lot better. No. So you see, a person is giving 50 years, maybe he would live one more day. What does it show us? That our life, something is wrong here. We're not doing the right thing. One person died, very rich guy, and they asked the rabbi to come say eulogy for him, hesped. So the rabbi came, so they told the rabbi who he was. He was a very successful businessman. So the rabbi started to say, there was maybe 1,000 people over there. He says, Itzik had a beautiful, beautiful company, great company, very successful. He had buildings almost in every state. And then 5 years ago, he bought the nicest yacht. It's in Europe, $100 million, special, mamash, whole custom made. He said in the eulogy, now all the people in the funeral, so what happened to this rabbi now? Yacht, company. Then he said, you know, he used to dye his hair. His hair used to be gray, he made it blonde. He put contact lens, he made his eyes blue. He used to buy every week a different car. He never wore once or twice. He was wearing it once and leaving it. And this, and that, and he went, he was maybe in every city in the world. So the father of the guy was 40, that he dies, the father comes to the rabbi, Rabbi, are you drunk? What are you saying? Say that he helped the poor, say that he gave money for the hospital 2 years ago, say that he was a good man. What is all this nonsense now? He bought a yacht, he bought a baseball team. What are, it's a funeral here. So the people got angry, they started to boo the rabbi. Boo, send him out of here. So they're starting to throw tomatoes, things, you know. So then the rabbi said, okay, I'm leaving. I finished, but before I leave, I just have one question to ask you. So everybody silent, you know, they're curious. What else this chatzuf wants to say? So he said to them, between me and you, I've been talking for 10 minutes. Did I say one lie? Did I exaggerate? Did I say exactly what this guy Itzik had or no? Did he have a yacht? They say yes. Did he have a beautiful company? Yes. Did he have blonde hair? Yes. He had a baseball team? Yes. What do you want from me? So he said, I'll tell you what's the problem. Since all of you losers live in a life of a lie, illusion, you run after what Itzik has, all of you dream to have what he has, and when I come to compliment you, when you finish your life for all your achievement, you're going to be embarrassed. So if it's an embarrassment to say it in your funeral, why you give all your life for this nonsense? If it's an embarrassment. If it was real, the father should scream, no, wait a minute, he also had another company. He had another yacht, rabbi, he didn't know about that. You know? You all know that you live in a lie, but you cannot live it. You know why? Because you don't have Torah. That's what it means, Baruch Ata Hashem Rofe Chole Amo Yisrael. Only the Torah can cure a person. The Ramchal says, Rabbi Moshe Chaim Lutzato 250 years ago in Padova, Italy. One of the biggest mekubalim we ever had. He wrote more than 100 books, and he lived just 40 years, that's it. So he wrote in his famous books, which was full of Kabbalah and Jewish philosophy, so he writes, there are two kinds of Jews. They both live in a darkness. So what does it mean two different kinds of Jews? One kind of Jews. They both in a darkness. So they're in one category. What does it mean two different kind of Jews? If they both in the dark, they search for the truth, so both of them are in the darkness. So why the Ramchal name it as two different categories? Because one of them just found out that he lives in the darkness. He didn't know yesterday, today he found out. Which means Both of them live in a choshech, but one just found out. So why, what's the difference now? They both are very sick. Two people, chas v'shalom, lo aleinu, have cancer. One just found out. The doctor just told him, look, here is the growth, it's spreading. The other one still do not know. They both take their convertible to go play golf. The one who did not find out, smoke his cigar, enjoying the music, enjoying the sun. Every time he hit the ball, he feels like he's on the top of the world. The other one doesn't want to hit the ball. He doesn't want cigar. He doesn't want music. He want to die. He's crying. So who looks happier? The one who found out that he's sick, or the one who doesn't know? Right now when we look at them, who look like a happy guy? The one who smoke his cigar. Who is really luckier? The one who found out his problem. Why? He has a chance, the Ramchal says, to cure himself. The other one does not have a chance. Most of the Jews in the world, they are not even aware that they are very, very sick. Very, their soul is dying for 50, 60 years, some of them. They never fed the soul 1 minute a day for the last 50 years. The soul is finished. They don't know. Bye-bye. Beitar, there's a game tomorrow. Let's buy garinim. We'll sit in the sun. Goal! They don't understand what they do here. They don't understand Hashem. They don't know Torah. They don't understand Torah milashon ora'a. Torah, it's instruction. They don't understand that this world is a ticket for life of eternity. They're wasting the opportunity. By the time they find out, it may be too late. Sometimes it's too late. How do I know? I gave a lecture a year ago in Great Neck, and who came to my lecture, believe it or not? The state controller of New York State, Alan Avesi. Until a year ago, he was in charge of all the money of New York State for more than 20 years. Every dollar ever came in and out of New York State under his signature. The unions, the schools, the courts, everyone is his employees. He approved the pension plans, where to invest, every very, very powerful person. Plus, he's a professor for history in his past, before he became a politician. So he comes, he argues about the Torah, if it's from God or the rabbis wrote it. You know, the same foolish questions that you hear every day. So after I answered him, and it's in my website, you can see the argument. Maybe 40, 45 minutes he is asking questions, and I answer his question. He's a very sharp person. Most of the people who ask questions, it's not even a challenge. But with this guy, it was very difficult, because he was asking very strong questions. So after that, I asked him, Mr. Avesi, what do you have to say after the lecture? He said, I still have some doubts. So I said, okay, Baruch Hashem, we made a great progress. Before the lecture, he did not believe in anything. Now you have some doubts. Very good. Let's sit one-on-one. Let's sit one-on-one, and we'll see. Either I convince you, or you convince me. So we went to Kolbe in Queens. Maybe because of us, they closed. But before they closed the business, we sat there for 3 hours, and we argue. And then after 3 hours, he said, okay, I surrender. I surrender. The Torah is divine. The God of the Jews is the real God. The Torah is the only truth. And the Jews are lucky. They are the chosen people. So I said, so what are you going to do from now on? So he says to me, what do you expect me to do? I'm 68 years old. I am married to a Goya. Where will I even start? Just thinking how much he has to do to make tshuva, he gave up. Serious. That's called. Sometimes it's too late. Yes. Even though it's strong. Because if you would make even a partial tshuva, it's already something big in Shamayim. If you only correct 5% of who you are and you die, just thanks to that, Hashem will give you another life full of opportunities to become tzaddik in your next Gilgul. That's what it means. I feel a second before a person dies, he regrets. He says, Hashem, forgive me, I'm sorry for everything I've done. Maybe it will save him for the next opportunity. That's why it says, Ptach li petach, pitchu li petach ke pitcho shel machat. Open me in the size of a needle, and I open you for the whole world. ואפתח לכם כפתחו של אולם. One guy came to Or Sameach Yeshiva, his name is Dave. American young guy in his 20s, some from Michigan, some state. He doesn't know anything about Judaism. Somebody told him, come for a month, see what Torah is, what Judaism is. So he's in Yeshiva for a few weeks. He became Shomer Shabbat. In Yeshiva, it's easy to be Shomer Shabbat. Then after 3 months, something like that, that is in the Yeshiva, he says, I want to go back to my parents' house. It's too much for me to learn Torah all day. So the rabbis are begging him, don't go, don't go, don't go, stay. Whoa, there's no shul there, what are you going to do? He said, no, Rabbi, it's too much for me to stay. Don't worry, I'm going to stay Shomer Shabbat. He went back to his parents. First Shabbat he kept. Second Shabbat, he's already starting to ask questions. Who says the truth? Maybe they brainwashed me there. How do I know that I'm doing the right thing right now? All my friends going to the beach and I'm going to stay home doing nothing. I'm not going to turn the television on. There's a game. You know how the Yetzer Hara works. So he said, Hashem, you give me a sign. If you give me a sign between now and Shabbat, it was Friday afternoon, between now and Shabbat, then I'll keep Shabbat. You have to give me a clear sign. What do you think? Hashem gave him a sign between noon and Shabbat? The answer is no. You're not going to play the chalil, the flute, and Hashem will dance according to your music. That's not how it works. Torah says, "Lo tenasu et Hashem Elokechem." You have no permission to test me. I test you. You do not test me. That's the rules. Take it or leave it. You have no chance. No choice. That's the rules. You can argue with your friend. You can argue with your wife. You cannot argue with your creator. So what's happening? This guy wants a test. Hashem doesn't give him a test. What happened? Shabbat started. He's sitting with a remote control in his hand. Should I turn the television on or not? That's his question now. So he said to Hashem, you know what? I'm giving you a second chance. Between now and 12 o'clock. If you give me a sign between now and 12 midnight, then I'll become Shomer Shabbat for good. If not, that's it. I'm done. 12 o'clock arrive, no sign. En siman. He's about to turn the television on, but he says, ah, you know, after I kept already for a few months, yes, no, his heart is not letting him. So he says, okay, one last chance. Between now and 12:15, if by 12:15, you have 15 more minutes, that's it. You give me a sign, fine. If not, I turn the television on, but this time is for real. 12:15 arrive, what do you think? No sign. He turned the television on. What does he see? The Dave Letterman show. You know Dave Letterman? Sure, you know who he is. Okay, it's a talk show. Dave Letterman interview a Jew, somebody from Hollywood, and the Jew just told him, I just came back from Israel. So Dave Letterman asked him, oh, really? Can you say something in Hebrew? So that Jew say, yes, Shabbat Shalom, Dave. As soon as the guy from Or Sameach, his name is Dave, he turned the television on, what does he see on the screen? Shabbat Shalom, Dave. No, what else? Something like this happened 1 to 1,000,000. Can try 1,000,000 times after, he won't do it. For whatever reason, Hashem wanted to give him a sign. He kept him going to 12:15 when the show is on. And when that guy was interviewed, just 5 seconds before he asked him, can you say something in Hebrew? He turned the television on, and in his face, you see this Jew say, Shabbat Shalom, Dave. So obviously, Baruch Hashem, he got saved. The Torah says, you should know I'm your God, not believe. Believing means not knowing. You should know I'm your God. You should know I took you out of Egypt. You should, all the nations should know the hand of Hashem. You should know the God of your parents, of your fathers. Many, you should know, you should know, you should know. How I should know? How? I have 5 senses. I can see, I can touch, I can smell, I can taste, and I can hear. 5 senses. With the 5 senses, I cannot prove that Hashem exists. I cannot prove anything. So why Hashem keep telling me you should know, you should know? To know, it's 100%. Like, I know it's dark outside. I know it's not. I don't say I believe it's dark outside. I know it's dark. It's a big difference. Imagine a woman comes and they ask her, who is this boy? I believe he's my son. She says, I know it's my son. That's a different story. I believe. By the way, get out of here. You're not his mother. You believe. Maybe your belief is wrong. When a person says, I believe in God 80%, we just said, I do not believe in God 20%. If you say, I believe 80%, that means I have 20% doubt. Very hard to be religious when you have doubts about the Torah. The Torah, in every chapter, has scientific proofs that show no human being was able to write the Torah. Nobody, even take all the smartest people together ever live, tell them to write a fake book, they cannot write what's in the Torah. The Torah has full knowledge about all the galaxies. Remember, we only have telescope for 400 years from Galileo Galilei. When the Torah was written, it's 3,000 years before Galileo. Nobody knew about telescopes and galaxies. You can only see 6,000 stars in Shamayim from here. That's it. Without telescope, you don't see anything. And even if they had a primitive telescope, he cannot see the billions of galaxies like the satellites, right? So nobody was able to write all the galaxies and the stars, I created, unless if it's God. The renewal of the moon that we have every month, Rosh Chodesh, right? The Torah tells you it can never be less than 29 days and a half and two-thirds of the hour and 73 parts of the minute. If you calculate it in math, the cycle of the moon will never be less than 29.530589. Nobody was able to give such math 3,300 years ago. We didn't even have a calculator. Nobody knew to measure all the cycles of the moon every month for years after years. How? How could you measure? How do you know? There's no way to know. You see, it's the creator of the moon. The Torah says you will never find anything in the ocean that has scales and doesn't have fins. Never. Everything that has scales that you scratch it and they fall off, for sure have fins, snapirim. If we find one that doesn't, that's the end of the Torah, because it's not divine anymore. If there's a mistake in the book, it's not from God. God doesn't make mistakes. Every chapter of the Torah gives prophecies to the future. Everywhere you go in the Torah always speaks what's going to be. One day you go into the land, you will build Beit HaMikdash, and then you will make sins, and the Goyim will come from far away, Goy that you don't recognize their language. And they will come and they'll destroy the Beit HaMikdash and they will send you out to the exile and you go to Egypt and over there they'll buy you for a price of straw for the horse, like $5. And how are you going to go to Egypt? With boats. Why boats? You can walk to Egypt. Why to invest to bring such big boats to take 2 million Jews to Egypt when you can make them all walk? It's very cheap. Man, just make them walk. Make a line like the Nazis used to do. And let them walk for 3 days and they'll get to Egypt. Why have to bring boats from Rome to take them and sell them to Egypt? The Torah wrote all this and it happened one by one. Then you will build it again. Everything is in the Torah. Who could write such a thing? One prophecy after the other and the people, our brothers and sisters, are continue to sleep. How do you know? Who says? Prove to me. How do you know there's life after life? So the answer is, and we'll finish with that, and then if you have questions, the Torah says, "Lema'an tichye ata v'zar'acha ad olam." If you listen to me and you follow my instruction, you and your children after you would live for eternity. Ad olam means forever. You'll never die. Of course, we're all going to die after 70, 80 years here. We know it. Nobody lives forever here. But when Hashem speaks that you and your children would live forever to life of eternity, in case you wonder what is the reward in the next life, so the answer is, Tzadikim Yoshvim, the righteous Jews are there, Ve'atrotem L'Roshem, they have a special spiritual crown, whatever that means, I don't know, Ve'nehenim Miziv Ashchina, and enjoying the greatness of Hashem. Do you have anything better than this? Can you imagine a better reward than enjoying the greatness of God? Do you know that God made our soul, right? And if the soul will enjoy from His real greatness, nothing in this world can come next to it. In case you still have a doubt, this is what the Torah says: Yafa shaa achat shel korat ruach ba'olam haba mikol chaye ha'olam hazeh. Translation: 1 hour of a righteous Jew in the next life is greater, is better than all the pleasures of all the people, of all the generations in their entire life combined. Take all the people who ever lived here. Take what they have: money, food, women, sports, honor, beauty, children, anything you can think of that is pleasure. Put them all together. Of every person, of all the generation, from the beginning of the world to the end, you make a huge mountain of pleasure, of all the people, of all their life, will not be equal to the reward that Hashem promised in the written Torah, where to one righteous Jew for 1 hour in the next life. How much the Chilonim are losing if they only knew. It's hard, religious, primitive. If you know what you lose, you would make a beep. Where the person, they tell him, I want you to come tomorrow to work, and it's a very, very hard work. Very hard moving job. We have to pick up pianos, chairs, tables, refrigerator. I'm telling you, it's mamash like a slave in Africa. No, Azov, leave me alone. It's not for me. I'll give you $100 for it. Go find your friends. Leave me alone. No, 1,000. Even 1,000. No, I'm sorry, 1 billion. What time to be there? What time? Everything has a price. It's worth it to be a tzaddik in this world, for not only for the reward of the next life, for this world. Look at the people who raise their children in the right way, according to the Torah, the way the children behave. And look at all the other people who raise their children in public school. And you tell me the difference. One old man got an aliyah in Petach Tikva. He's 83 years old. Just when the rabbi called him on Shabbat to the Torah, he started to cry. He said, Baruch et Hashem Amor, he started to cry. He didn't finish the bracha. The rabbi asked him, are you okay? He cries, he cannot relax. After he relaxed, the rabbi asked him, I'm sorry, but what happened? He said, this is the second time in my whole life that I see a Torah. The last time I saw a Torah was in my bar mitzvah. For 1 hour, I saw it. That was exactly 70 years ago when I was 13. Today is my birthday, I'm 83. And I came here accidentally to the shul. I was by this guy, he convinced me to come to the shul. I had never been in a shul for 70 years. And now when I came to the shul, you gave me this aliyah, so I just remember what the rabbi told my father 70 years ago in my bar mitzvah. That's why I cried. So the rabbi asked him, what did he tell your father? He said, he told my father, tell me, where is your son learning? I never saw his face in his town. So my father told him, he goes to learn by the goyim, in public school. Remember, a public school 70 years ago was better than some of the yeshivot today. Just let you understand what was public school then. Today, public school is worse than jail. Knives, this, metal detector, tattoos, all kinds of crazy rap music. Hashem irachem, to send a Jew there, it's mamash, you hate your son if you send him there. Better he'll be home with no education at all than to get the education that they give over there. Even if the teachers are good, the level of the people there, Hashem irachem. I see them sometimes in the buses, they come out, Brooklyn, Queens, you see what they talk, how they look, you understand everything. So, the public school 70 years ago, it was classy. Still, it's a public school. They teach you that you used to be a monkey. So, he says to him, the rabbi, he goes to public school, you're not afraid of your child's soul? Quick, transfer him to the yeshiva. So my father said, no, no, it's not for me. I want him to be a doctor. I want him to be a lawyer. It's too much, the yeshiva. You know, the excuses are always the same. So the rabbi told him, I'm afraid that if you won't transfer tomorrow your son to the yeshiva, the next time your son will see the Torah will be in 70 years from now. Not afraid? My father was a little bit embarrassed. We got out of there and we went home. And today it's exactly 70 years. After that day, I was in my bar mitzvah, and today it's my birthday, I'm 83. So the rabbi in Petach Tikva asked him, that was a few years ago, this story, a few years ago. So the rabbi asked him, what was the name of that rabbi? He told him it was the chief rabbi of Ashkenaz, Rabbi Chaim Oizer, the big rabbi. You see his books everywhere. So the rabbi of the shul in Petach Tikva almost fainted. And if he sat on a chair and started to cry. Now all the people in the shul, until now, this old man was crying. Now it's the rabbi crying. Rabbi, what happened? He said, don't you get what's going on here? Don't you see? So he said, Rabbi, what? He said, what's the name of this shul in Petach Tikva? Bet HaKnesset. Rabbi Chaim Oizer in Rabbi Chaim Oizer Street in Petach Tikva. The shul called Rabbi Chaim Oizer. Go to Petach Tikva, you see this shul. Next time you go to Israel. In Rehov, Rabbi Chaim Oizer, there's a shul, Rabbi Chaim Oizer, named after that rabbi from 70 years ago that he told the old man when he was a kid. Next time you see the Torah will be in 7 years. Where did Hashem send him to see the Torah, like the tzaddik said? In a shul that named after him. Coincidence? Huh? Coincidence? I know I say we finished, but give me just one more minute. I'll tell you a story even better than this. I came to give a lecture here in Queens a few years ago. I see a red-haired girl, 20 years old. Regina, her name. From Russian background. Her parents came from Russia. She already grew up here. But they're very poor. We couldn't afford to go to yeshiva when her parents came to America. So they went to an organization that raised money from rich people to send Jewish kids to yeshiva. Russian helping Russian. So they went to that organization and they said, we'll try to find a sponsor for yeshiva that she won't go to public school. So this girl, when she saw me in a lecture, she came to me and asked me, do you have maybe a shidduch for me, somebody in Muncie, in your yeshiva? I'm looking for a guy who learns Torah. I'm very religious. I don't care about anything. Just a tzaddik that learns Torah I want. I told her, write down your information and I'll try to find you one. If I have somebody, I'll let you know. A few months later, I came back to the same place. I'm setting up my laptop, everything, the screen, everything. The husband and wife that are arranging the lecture, I asked them, your friend Regina didn't come this time. So she told me, no, she just got married 2 weeks ago. I said, oh, Baruch Hashem. So she asked me, do you want to hear how she got married? No, I'm putting the laptop together. I have a minute or two. I have 100 chilonim, 100 secular guys and girls waiting for a lecture of proofs. So I told her, yeah, why not? Tell me how she got married. She told me when she was a kid, we grew up in the same class. She never had a quarter once in her life. No candy, no lollipop, no money for bus, nothing. Never had money. That's how poor she was. The organization went to a Russian Jew, not religious, from Mill Basin here in Brooklyn. Mill Basin. They told him, as a little girl, it's up to you. You give the $800-$900 a month, she goes to good yeshiva. Not, she'll go to public school, who knows what's going to be. You have money, Baruch Hashem, help us. The guy said, okay, every month I'll pay for her. He's been sponsoring her for years. One day this Regina got to a place, I think it was a library or something. She sits over there with her skirt and everything. One not religious girl comes to her. She recognizes she's Jewish. So the not religious Jew asks her, are you married, single? She said, no, I'm single. I'm looking for shidduch. She said, I have a shidduch for you. So she told her, who? She said, my brother. So Regina told her, no, I'm very religious. Look, you know, you're not religious. I need Shomer Shabbat, learn Torah. She said, that's why I came to you. My brother is a serious Baal Tshuva. He became very religious. He just went to Yeshiva in Monsi for 6 months. He came now home. He's searching for Shidur. He's very religious. He wants to learn Torah. So she said, oh, in that case, maybe it can work out. She set them up together, this not religious girl. They go up a few times, fell in love right away. Perfect match. Now it's time to bring her parents to meet his parents. So they make a l'chaim party. So the poor girl with her parents come to the address that they gave them. They invited all these friends from the yeshiva. They made a nice party in her house. As they just meeting the families, what did they find out? That the guy who was paying the tuition for her yeshiva for 16 years is the father of the chatan. The guy who was paying for this Regina to go to yeshiva prepared his own daughter-in-law. Hashem said, you save the soul, it will be yours. Here, to your son. What a nice tzaddikah this girl is. See what's going on here? Chiloni, he made one great mitzvah. Look at his reward. He got the greatest daughter-in-law. See what nice personality she has. She'll never make a beef. She'll never argue. She doesn't want anything. Just Torah, Kedusha. Like a dream of every father. No, Ashgacha or coincidence? Can it be something like this coincidence? 6.4 billion people in the world. Who Hashem sent to her? The son of the guy who gave the money. Can it be by itself? It's better than proofs. Why do you need proofs? Just look at the Ashgacha in the world. I have books like this, with stories like this. This, something happened to me personally. But they have books in the library. Or have Ashgacha. Of stories with names of people. You can't believe when you read it. And sometimes we have doubts. We have doubts because we don't learn everyday Torah. Im ein ani li mi li. If I won't take care of my soul, nobody will do the job for me. Not the rabbi, not my kids, not my wife, only me. וכשאני לעצמי מה אני? If I'll try to do everything on my own, it's also not good. I need the help of the חכמים to direct me. ואם לא עכשיו ומתי, return today, פרקי אבות זה. Make תשובה one day before you die. When will I die? I don't know. Maybe it's tomorrow. So I gotta do it now. Tomorrow may be too late. בעזרת השם, again, thank you to Onen.